Hello everyone. So this screencast is going to talk about the topics of nutrient cycling and energy flow, specifically in the epipelagic zone of the ocean. So if you remember, the ocean is divided up into major zones in the pelagic zone, the epipelagic, mesopelagic, bathypelagic, and abyssopelagic. In ocean trenches, we call it the hadropelagic zone. Each zone has many distinct characteristics, but tend to center on a few things. Each zone has varying amounts of light, oxygen, temperature, and nutrients that tend to be present in it. The amount of each of these variables is going to determine what kinds of animals can live successfully in each of these environments. Before we dive into the details of nutrient cycling and energy flow, it's helpful to think about how each of these characteristics varies across all the ocean zones. Light tends to vary in a linear fashion, with the most light being in the epipelagic zone and the least light being in the abyssopelagic or hadropelagic layers. Oxygen tends to be slightly more complex, however. There's a large amount of oxygen in the epipelagic zone thanks to transference from the air and the mixing of oxygen in from the waves. We also have lots of photosynthetic organisms that live here, such as phytoplankton. In the lower zones, however, we don't have crossover from the air into the water, and we also don't have photosynthetic organisms because there isn't enough light. Furthermore, there is also a large amount of decomposition that happens in this area right here. The bacteria use up a lot of the available oxygen. However, we can get some oxygen mixed in at the lower levels thanks to thermohaline circulation. Temperature also has an interesting profile. Once we move out of the epipelagic zone, the water tends to get extremely cold. There is some circulation that happens due to lighter water being less dense and being warmer, but most of the time it's extremely cold at the lower depths unless you happen to be near an ocean vent. Nutrients also tend to follow the profile of light. There are a lot of nutrients in the epipelagic zone, but the deeper you go, the less nutrients tend to be available. Again, the exception to this is when you happen to be near an ocean vent, which we'll talk about later on this term. Ocean vents tend to bring in new nutrients from inside the Earth. As you can see, it would be extremely challenging to live in the abyssopelagic or hadropelagic zones because of the lack of light, lack of oxygen, lower temperatures, and lack of nutrients. Organisms that manage to live here must have very specific adaptations that allow them to survive. In any ecosystem, the environment tends to influence the organisms, and the organisms also tend to influence the environment in turn. Two of the ways that this happens are through energy flow and nutrient cycling. These interactions include both living and non-living factors. For instance, the kelp forest is often a home to many different kinds of organisms. Fish may eat the kelp for food and may also use it for shelter. However, the fish may also provide nutrients for the kelp when it decomposes its food. The fish also tend to help keep the kelp forests in check by eating the weak or damaged leaves. This allows the kelp forest to grow stronger and more healthily. The kelp forest also undergoes photosynthesis and produces oxygen, which the fish needs to breathe. The fish takes in the oxygen from the kelp and exhales carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is then taken in by the kelp forest so that it can undergo more photosynthesis. Nutrient cycling involves many different kinds of organisms. These include producers, consumers, and decomposers. Producers tend to create their own food, which means that they are photosynthetic. We can also call producers autotrophs. Consumers eat producers. There are primary, secondary, and tertiary consumers. Occasionally, you'll also have quaternary consumers, but not very often for reasons that we'll see in a bit. Decomposers break down dead producers and dead consumers. Here's an example of a stereotypical ocean food chain, starting with phytoplankton, then zooplankton, then small fish, and then larger fish. The nutrients will flow from the phytoplankton to the zooplankton when the zooplankton eats the smaller phytoplankton. When any of these organisms die, they're broken down by decomposers, and the nutrients flow back into the cycle again. Another important consideration in ecosystems is energy flow. In the epipelagic zone, the energy originates in the sun. The light energy travels to the Earth in the form of photons of light, which then nourish the photosynthetic organisms that live near the top of the epipelagic zone. These photosynthetic producers take light from the sun, and they also take in carbon dioxide. They use the process of photosynthesis to produce oxygen and also to produce sugars in the form of glucose. The energy then flows down the food chain into the primary consumers. Then the energy goes on to the secondary consumers. The energy can then move on from the secondary consumers to the tertiary consumers. Now let's look at the energy flow a little bit more closely. We're going to do this by looking at the number of organisms that might theoretically be at each level of the food chain, or potentially at the number of calories of food that might be at each level. The number of creatures at each level of the food chain decreases the farther down the list you move. So you'll notice that there are a lot of photosynthetic producers, but not very many tertiary consumers. This decrease in numbers is called the 10% rule. The 10% rule states that only 10% of the energy at one level can then move on to the next level. Let's take the example of 1 million photosynthetic phytoplankton as an example. Zooplankton preys upon phytoplankton, and so we're going to need to have fewer zooplankton than we do phytoplankton. A population of 1 million phytoplankton can only support a population of 100,000 zooplankton. Much of this energy differential is accounted for by heat and also by the daily activities that phytoplankton would go through. If we continue to move up the ladder, a population of 100,000 primary consumers could only support 10% as many secondary consumers. Again, a lot of the energy is lost as heat, and also in the process of finding a mate and searching for food. If we continue to go down the food chain, we'll see that this population can only support 1,000 tertiary consumers. So even though we started with a very large number of photosynthetic producers, by the time we get to tertiary consumers, there's very little energy left. Not many ecosystems can support quaternary consumers, and it's probably pretty easy to guess why. If we follow the 10% rule, a population of 1 million producers can only support 100 quaternary consumers, and that's if conditions are ideal. When we look at this structure, it's not difficult to understand why populations of sharks and tuna tend to be much smaller than populations of zooplankton or phytoplankton, and also why overfishing is so dangerous to these populations. There really just aren't that many of them to begin with. Furthermore, these species are further threatened because they tend to reproduce very slowly and take many years to reach sexual maturity. Because it takes them so long to reproduce, the populations grow even more slowly than they would normally. Unfortunately, it's very difficult to convince people that they should make sushi out of photosynthetic producers or out of zooplankton rather than out of tuna. One final thing to remember about energy flow is that none of the energy winds up back at its original source, unlike nutrient cycling. It'll be important to keep some of these similarities and differences in your mind as we go through the rest of this unit. That's it. See you all in class.